Well, hi, Kemosabes. It's Tony D'Angelo. It is September 28th, 2023, out of Dominion, the year of our Lord. So happy to have you here with us this particular day. We have two subjects today, and I want to, first of all, thank our music contributors and copyright owners who graciously allow us to use their music on this broadcast. I think it adds a lot, and I am so grateful. It's now a challenge to me to dig out songs which I haven't heard in years and play them and, you know, get people talking about them, or maybe get people talking about me. But in the interest of time, our first subject today, we're going to get right down to it, is the Bridgeport ballot scandal. Now, in looking at this, what I am not going to do is to go over ground previously covered. I think it's well covered. It's covered by a number of different people. There's a number of impressions that are out there. And I think that if you look at it, you can read a number of articles and formulate your own mind. One of the reasons why I so love and respect the George Colley site, the Connecticut Capitalist, is because George gives you a lot of things to pull from and says, make up your own mind, draw your own conclusions, see how this is being covered, see the biases, see the issues, see the cover-ups, see the state-run influences, and then you can actually get to what's actually happening. But I would like to talk about an issue really in this ballot and in the city of Bridgeport that I don't think you're going to see covered anywhere. And it's just where, you know, my particular interest takes me. With that, I'm going to go over here and I'm going to see if I can do a share screen really quickly. And I'm going to share and watch my, and here we are. This is a blog article. And this is from something called Only in Bridgeport, written by Lenny Grimaldi. Some of you may be familiar with Lenny. Lenny was in one of the early Joe Ganim administrations, and there's a long story about that, which I won't get into in the interest of time, but tells you kind of a whole lot of how Bridgeport works and how it operates and that sort of thing. But Lenny has made a newspaper, if you will, of things that he considers to be interesting. And I've been looking at this, and a lot of it is, in fact, interesting. I may agree with some of it. I may disagree with some of it, but that's the idea. I read about this gentleman who you're probably not going to hear about. His name is David Herz, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. He is a Jewish man, and he is a Republican candidate for mayor. He is running on a very traditional platform of things that would align with the conservative movement, things like private property rights, and there's only two genders. And he has a very good, shall we say, statement, if you will, in Lenny Grimaldi's blog. And he talks about the truth, and he talks about the evils of bad programs, and. One comment I like here: we are not systematically racist or oppressive. I don't deny that we may have been in the past. I don't deny that there still may be effects of our prior institutional racism. The remedy was to erase those racist barriers, certainly not to teach victimhood today or to institute other racist measures in the name of equity. To quote Derek Wilburn, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, a direct descendant of slaves on both sides, we are victims of our own ignorance, our own laziness, and our own poor decision-making. Now, I can do an entire, going to stop that share, I can do an entire show on that. But basically, I found this to be refreshing. There is a Republican running in Bridgeport. Sad thing is, he's probably underfunded. Knowing the history of the Connecticut State Party, he's ostensibly undersupported, and this poor gentleman is not going to be able to get to where he needs to go. I don't like to damn things before they begin, but unfortunately, I've seen this play out once before. But Mr. Hurst, and I'm not saying I support his candidacy or I am against it, I do find it interesting. He is promoting himself as an alternative, and he hits upon something which I don't even think Mr. Hers realizes that he's hitting on, which is the destruction of the American city. I was chatting with somebody a few days ago, and we were chatting about the Connecticut city. Now, I came into New Haven actually in, 1984, with a red pencil and a newspaper and $5 of gas in the tank of my Oldsmobile, you know, couch surfing. Other than that, you know, basically homeless, trying to find a job. So the first thing I did when I got into town is I bought a copy of the New Haven Register and I started knocking on doors. Well, when I did this, I, you know, really had never been into New Haven with any real, shall I say, interest beyond, like, you know, doing one task, like a, you know, maybe a sports game or going to the New Haven Coliseum or something like that. I started to get into the community. I eventually bought a home there as a young person. And I noticed that, at least for me, it was a place where Black and white got along, at least in the world where I was, as peers, as neighbors, as people that work together. And what I found was something that I really didn't find in my hometown of Stamford, Connecticut, at least not growing up. In Stamford, we had sections, you know, the Italians had a section, which was the West Side. The Polish and the Slovak had a section, which was down by the cove. The Irish had a section, you know, which was Springdale and the Polish and. But there wasn't like a lot of going back and forth. But I was really amazed and warm-hearted at just the fact of people just getting along, owning homes side by side, doing what they want to do, basically, which is raise their kids, have a home, have a family, be safe and grow, and enjoy the benefits of their labors. I mean, what's so horrible about that? Well, there's a number of people that would probably consider that to be horrible. That all said, in the city of Bridgeport, I'll take Bridgeport. Same thing happened in New Haven. There was a very large, functional, productive Black and person of color, if you prefer that that description, people of color, working middle class, people that owned homes and own homes. And there are some that still do. Where I've noted it most recently is off of Park Avenue in the streets of the presidents. I like to call Taft, McKinley, Harding, Roosevelt. And the homes are very nice old homes. They're Victorians and Tudors. You're not going to see a lot of them together anymore in Connecticut, but it's really the kind of thing where these homes were owned and populated and purchased by people of color that were, you know, middle class. They had managerial occupations. Now, they worked in, the administrations, or they worked in the post office. The post office ran extremely well as a postal customer, as a business owner for years and years and years. It ran extremely well when it had a large person of color managerial class that were running the thing and running it well. Now, I don't know what's happened in recent years. You know, it's kind of a lot of the mail these days is hit and miss. But that said, when this particular group was devolved or encouraged to retire, whatever the case may be, postal service went down. And there was an interest of people of all colors in this community to have a safe community, have good schools. have properties be desirable, have a community to go to church to encourage one another, to have vehicles of one's choice. And this was all there. Now, what has happened in the past 20 years? Me, myself, and I tend to think there were two things. There was the administration of Barack Obama, which actually accelerated the demise of this, I'll call it a black middle class, by making retirement kind of a forced event, and also getting these people to effectively not have their employment, which leads to the other part of it, which is we had in Connecticut a very strong, you know, I'm going to call it arms industry, defense industry, AFCO Lycoming, Teleregister in Stanford, Bunkeramo, we still have Sikorsky and Pratt and Whitney, but they're not what they used to be. And also, you know, the ballistics factories, Remington, Marlin, and a lot of the craftspeople came up from the South. They were persons of color, and they were, you know, gun makers. Now, I am of the belief that a gun itself never killed anybody. You know, Colonel Rob Simmons on the Lee Elsie show, one of my co-panelists, has a great, shall I say, object lesson, where he walked into the studio with a couple of guns and put them on the counter and dared them to kill somebody. They're not going to. But basically, when we started to chip away at the gun factories and the really good manufacturing, not we, but the system and the powers that be, largely Democratic, this began to erode the black middle class. Now, the other thing was drugs. I can't tell you, you know, when I was a younger homeowner in New Haven County, Connecticut, how many black grandparents I ran into that were raising their grandchildren because the parents got fried on drugs. And, you know, I can go on for days and days and days about that, but there is so much money being made. And for the great Democrats of the past to say, we will protect the black people, they did absolutely nothing to protect these particular kids from getting hung up on drugs and keeping the drugs out. That all said, I can go on for days about that, but that leads us to the present day. I have a very good friend, I will not mention his name, who is employed in the city of Bridgeport in a municipal office, and we chat from time to time to time. And I talk with him, actually it was last week, and I said, what's going on with the ballot thing? And he just started to laugh and said, well, you know, everybody knows Joe's corrupt. Everybody knows Joe Ganim's corrupt. It is an accepted part of life where we are. And then I asked them, well, how did Wanda get in to actually do what she did so early in the morning? People are asking that question. No one has an answer. And basically, he chuckled and he said, you know, well, you know, kind of the I do my job as best as I can, but this is what life is in Bridgeport. But he said something which was very, very, very telling to me, which is we have a contingent, if you will, of homeowners in the city of Bridgeport, people that work in City Hall, who really understand everything about Joe Ganim, but are praying that he wins. Now, you may think that is incongruous, you know, where you come from. You may think that is absolutely nonsensical. But basically, it's Joe Ganim is the last bit of any kind of fiscal sanity that this city will ever experience, because Joe Ganim is not going to, in his mind, throw incredible amounts of money at education other than what he's been throwing. Now, from what I understand about the person challenging him for the Democratic primary, John Gomes, John is a major progressive that wants to dump more money into education. Now, you could debate that. Personally, I think it's nonsense because you don't need a lot of money for good education. You need discipline and you need desire, and you will be educated. You know, it's all the money in the world is not going to help you be a better student. Money strategically placed in certain spots will make you better, but certainly programs aren't going to actually solve anything. Mr. Gomes, from what I understand, I'm not talking out of school, is a big progressive program man. If that's what you want, Mr. Gomes is there for you. That all said, that really grips something to me because people still want the way the system used to be. What was wrong with it? You know, their parents and grandparents owned homes. Their parents and grandparents had really nice cars. Their parents and grandparents went on vacation and sent kids through school. Now, if we are going to have this whole wonderful progressive, oh, we're going to spend everything that we can and life is going to be wonderful and everybody's going to have really good housing and from a government that does absolutely nothing but screw things up to the nth degree and just create jobs for, bureaucrats on end, why would we want to, number one, why do we want to do that? And the other thing is, what is so wrong with the system that worked? You know, it's like if I'm going to listen to, sadly, a liberal white politician, if I'm a person of color and I'm going to listen sadly to a liberal white politician tell me everything I need to know and tell me everything I need to do and make me dependent on him for the same nonsense, why am I going to bother? But just that one nugget, that one bit, where my friend told me that, we are praying for Joe Ganim to win because this way, at least our houses won't be taken away from us for even more ridiculous taxation and more programs and more crud in this city where, people don't, this is the laughable thing. People do not want what the current Democrat Party wants to give them. They are giving them something that they think is very good and very convenient. And, we've got this and we've got transit and we've got housing and we're going to get your wages up and we'll protect you all. But none of that, I mean, they have no economic sense. None of that is going to sustain anything, basically. But if you give people skill, if you give them industry, I get into so many fights and where, the shall I say, the liberally or modern Democrat person runs away from me is I said, well, you want to do all these wonderful things, but why are you so angry about the fact of you need an economy? You need lower taxation. You need safety. You need better education to compete on a world stage. No, because once you have that, you don't need these buzzards. You don't need these knuckleheads. And that's the part that bothers them the most. So it's a sad state of affairs in a city like Bridgeport, where a guy who basically with a very checkered reputation is the best possible hope. I mean, I give Mr. Herz, who we read about at the beginning of this discussion, a lot of credit to do something. He's probably not going to do anything, and that's really the sad thing. But I will say this, though, however, to Republicans who in this state don't seem to be catching on to much of anything. If you guys actually had a campaign where you went and talked to people in the city, the people with, skin in the game, the homeowners, the business owners, and said, look, this is what they want to do. This is our agenda of, lower taxes or simple taxes and police protection and fossil fuel, and we're going to push back against this numbskullery of climate change. You're going to find a lot of people that would start voting for you if you were serious in that. Honestly, a lot of people say you're Democrat light, in many respects you are, sadly enough, and that's not going to get you the cities, and you're going to need the cities to win. I hate to tell you that, but all of that kind of being as it is, it's when you start to look at what is there in the city, yeah, the frauds in Connecticut, we have almost become immune. Was saying the other day, today is ballot fraud. Yesterday was semaphore. Before that, or actually after that, was Digital Currency Group, Unite CT, Advanced CT. On and on and on and on we go. It's like the frog in the water, turning the heat up. Just another fraud. But the guts of what need to be fixed really were in what was being done, what was bought and fought for so long ago of, equality of all people and equal opportunity, and not this equity jibe and not these progressive plans. Sorry, Mr. Gomes, but more spending is not going to help the Bridgeport schools. What is going to help the Bridgeport schools is discipline, attention, focus, and teaching the right things as opposed to, gobbledygook. That's what's going to do it. I respect your sincerity, but I would ask for you to rethink that. That all said, why do we have to keep redoing the wheel when the wheel was done before? It's because the progressive knuckleheads, mostly white liberals, don't want to redo it, or they want to redo it because it doesn't include them. It's simple as that and just as difficult. That's just another prism, another lens, another focus that I'd like to give you in a city in Bridgeport. Good things can happen in a place like Bridgeport. You've got great old Victorian homes. You've got a really good harbor. You've got great transportation, but what you need is leadership and trust in government, inclusive of all people and giving them the opportunity and actually knocking down the tax rate and making it a place to happen as opposed to a place to avoid. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. We're cooking and we'll be right back in 60 seconds.
Thanks for being here on 30 with Tony. 30 with Tony is an independent podcast production of Tony D'Angelo, managing director of the Paragon Trust Company of New Haven, Connecticut, and a news commentator on various network productions. The views expressed are those of Tony D'Angelo and of no other person or party. If you would like to message Tony, please do so on his Twitter page, address at TonyDeAngelo70R, by email at FortReestrust@AOL.com. Feel free to pass along whatever thoughts you may have. Please be advised that this slot may be purchased for advertising. All advertising revenues from this particular endeavor will be donated to Interfaith Human Services of Putnam, Connecticut. Thanks so much for being here, and have a great day.
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. In our second discussion today, I would like to talk about this particular subject, one of which I have had personal experience with on several occasions, professional experience with in my life as a practitioner and a trust officer, and as a Christian human being. And it is called the right to die. And I pray once again here as to where to begin. Why don't I begin with the screen share? Let's start with that. And if I'm doing this correctly, I'm going to go over to here. And I'm going to share my screen. And I'm going to go to this article I came across on the Connecticut News Junkie. And this is an article. The author of the article is Hugh McQuaid. And it's called, the title of it is "The Aid in Dying Advocate is Going to Walk Connecticut to Build Public Support." And there is a gentleman, his name is Tim Appleton. He is an advocate for aid in dying. He plans to spend the next 5 weeks crisscrossing Connecticut on a foot campaign to build public pressure on state lawmakers, using the language in the article, to build public pressure on state lawmakers to pass long-stalled legislation allowing terminally ill adults to end their own lives with medication. And you can read the article. I mean, I believe it's well-written. And he, Mr. Appleton, is the campaign director for the Compassion and Choices Advocacy Group. And he borrowed the walk idea from Senator Chris Murphy. And he felt that the walk is more or less of a, shall I say, an example of the agony and suffering of those who have literally died waiting for this legislation to pass. Now, I'm going to stop the share here for a moment give you a little bit of personal background. I personally, I've been involved in, tax trust estates, tax planning, advocacy for years and years and years and years, oftentimes more years than I care to think about. And I am a strong believer in having, in different jurisdictions, they're called different things, but I am an incredibly strong believer in having an estate plan, a will, simple bean stuff, most of us can get along very well with simple beans, and also having something known in Connecticut as a healthcare proxy. This is a person who will be empowered to make decisions for you should you be in a position medically, emotionally, cerebrally in your head, mentally, where you cannot make decisions for yourself. If you do not have this particular document in place, the institution will make these decisions for you. And given the institutions which I have run into in this state and in others, they will make the decisions based upon their particular best interests and not your own. That also said, as one, shall we say, professional trip, if you can call what I do sometimes a profession. Some days it's so dirty, you could, if there were headroom, you could hold the things in sewers. But that all said, it is well worth the money to have your proxy professionally drafted by somebody who actually knows what the heck they're writing about, and not just some, ham and egg practitioner who does this, in between doing, real estate closings and, landlord tenant disputes and things like that. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but basically when it actually comes down to exercising a proxy, a little bit of language going the right way or the wrong way can make all the difference. That said, as one with personal experience, I had a proxy on my first wife, Jean. She had one on me because we had discussed it. Married couples need to discuss this, as painful as it is. I know you'll love her. I know you'll love him. But in a God forbid situation, do you want to be kept alive? If you're in a situation where you can't speak for yourself, some people want to be kept alive at all costs. Other people do not. That's something that needs to be discussed. And whatever your preferences are, whatever they may be, and they're entirely up to you, you need to have that in the document. But secondly, with that, I have been called many times. I can't tell you. I have to count them in my head. As the proxy, as the person chosen to execute on behalf of the, shall we say, the terminally ill person, to execute and actually put the thing into preference. I have a discussion with people and I say, when they're well and they're able, what is your preference on this? Do you want nutrition and hydration? Should things get very bad, or do you want to be left to peacefully die? Do you want other life-saving methods like CPR and things like that, or do you not? Should your situation be deemed, I always believe there's hope. I believe in divine healing, but I believe that's a decision people have to make on their own, as far as what they themselves believe. What do you want? And it would be my job as a proxy, or a very good proxy, whom you've really got to appoint somebody when you do this, who basically is going to have your interests at heart and is going to be able to act based upon what you would want them to do and not get balled up in some emotional thing based upon, their own, shall we say, preferences. But that all said, these are things you need to discuss. Have a good proxy, have a good agreement. And in a God forbid situation, if you were like me, in the situation I was with Jean, prepare to do battle with a hospital institution that does not want to grant you what your dying wish may be, because oftentimes, me, myself, and I, I believe it's not profitable for them when they can continue to leave somebody on life support or treatment and prolong their life, a few extra months or something like that, and hand you the bill. And if that's okay with you, great. If you want to do that, that is your preference. If you choose in advance not to do that, you've saved money. You don't want to have a large fight being shall we say, with not a long life prognosis, and you're ready to meet your maker peacefully, that should be up to you. Some stupid institution and some hospital administrator does not have to get involved in your personal decisions, whatever they may be, nor any physician. That's where I come down on this thing. But that all said, there is legislation that has been proposed in Connecticut, the, if I have the terminology correctly, the medical aid to the right to die. That's the gist of it. And this particular gentleman is going to be walking and saying, we need to pass this legislation. Now, when it comes to the, actually taking something to end one's life, I personally am not in favor of that. I've never been in that situation personally. Thank the good Lord Jesus Christ. But the that choice is that particular person's choice as far as what they would want to do. And it shouldn't be a fixed choice. It should be something that, you should be able to consider at the time. But when you actually start to look at this law in Connecticut, it is, even though I understand the, shall I say, the intention of it, it is the exactly wrong thing to do. But oftentimes, I sit on this show and I sit on the Lee Elsie show and I say, when does Connecticut ever do the right thing? Because when you study this law in Connecticut, it has three separate layers of bureaucracy in order to actually get to the fact of attaining your particular right to die and to hasten your own demise. There is an actor, I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with him, James Naughton, fine actor, and he has acted, has a brother, David Naughton, and he has been crusading in several years, for several years, for this particular law. Now, where I respect Mr. Naughton having personal experience with a dying spouse, as I have had, and having your spouse come to you and saying, I can't do this anymore. I'm in so much pain. I want, for my life to end peacefully, and I don't want to be kept alive by some medical means, and having to fight the godforsaken system in order to ensure one's right to do it. I get what Mr. Naughton is saying, but I wish what Mr. Naughton would do is not look at, because he is a person of influence, look at these literally three levels of bureaucracy in Connecticut in order to get to that point, if that is what you choose to do. I ask the question as a practitioner, as a professional, as a Christian, and also as one who has sat in this driver's seat, not a seat you want to be in, on a number of occasions saying, why does the freaking government have to get involved at all? Why does the stupid rear-end Connecticut bureaucracy have to insert themselves in what is really a personal decision? For example, if, I am married to Kathy, pray for Kathy, folks, but I am married to Kathy, and I've had this discussion with Kathy, and pretty much I've said, when I can no longer do for myself, I do not want to be here. Doing for myself is the greatest joy and privilege I have in life. Now, that's a relative concept, as far as, maybe I can't run as fast as I used to or lift the same amount of weight I did, and. But I believe I'm still pretty darn productive. That all said, when I can no longer do for myself, I no longer be here. She understands it. Now, when it comes for me to accept the fact of, I am on the exit ramp of life. We're all going to get there. The idea is not to get there any sooner than you're supposed to. And that could be a show in and of itself. But that all said, why would Kathy have to fight 9,000 layers of bureaucracy, spend all kinds of time, spend all kinds of money, burn through what little money we have in order to go ahead and please a bureaucracy? Why can't it be something as simple as, all of the next of kin and the person agree that they do not want any more treatment. This is where that proxy is very important, and having that proxy correctly drafted, you know, because when you have to exercise a proxy, I tell you, you will be going to war. It is not an automatic. That all said, that when, if you do choose, if it is your choice to medically induce your dying, that should be your choice. I shouldn't tell you what to do. The freaking stupid ass bureaucracy and the politicians and the medical system should not tell you what to do. You should be able to do that on their own. And like, well, where's the safeguard, Tony? This person could be crazy. Well, let's have the family agree that this is something they all want to do, and have like one officer of the state who has to make a decision inside of 24 hours, say, okay, it's an automatic unless we could really, you know, kind of figure out, you know, you only have a hurry time to figure out as to somebody's tweaking this particular person. No system's going to be perfect, but most people who are waiting to go and leave this earth are not going to do so casually. They would have given it a lot of thought. And the people that are the most affected, which are their next of kin, are the ones that should be speaking up or out about this thing, and not some idiot bureaucracy. Now, I also catch it from Christians, and I'm sure I'm going to catch it from Christians here, saying, how could you even do such a thing, Tony D'Angelo? You call yourself a Christian. You call yourself one that loves God, and you're talking about any sort of thing. Only God has the right to life. I'm glad you raised that question. Let's go back to our share. And I'm sure if you are a Christian, you respect the words of Paul the Apostle. I personally love the epistles of Paul the Apostle. And I'm going to swing you over here, if I can. And actually, I kind of messed that up. Bear with me for just a second. Oh, here we go. Okay. This is the my favorite version of the Bible, the King James Bible. And if you go over here, Paul's talking about the end of his life, and he's giving his charge to Timothy, and he says, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is now at hand. I have fought the good fight. I've finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but also them also that love his appearing." Now, what Paul is saying to Timothy here is, kid, I've done every single thing I could, and I'm really ready to get out of here. I am ready to be offered. And that is a way of saying I am ready to accept my demise. Now, if you read about Paul the Apostle, Paul the Apostle was beheaded. So Paul effectively submitted himself to be beheaded. He didn't fight. He didn't scream. He was of sound mind. He said, I'm done. I'm through. This is over. It's time for you to carry the ball. And I mean, where you are, if you are a Christian person, I'm going to knock this down. And if you are a Christian person, you somehow have to explain to me that if you are, you know, life at all costs, no matter what, and, you know, the institution should get in and protect life, you've got to explain to me Paul the Apostle, who said he was ready. And I mean, if you have somebody who's worked hard all their life and they've got a home and they've got an insurance policy and they've been given a very hard reality by the doctor saying, you know, you have 2 months to live or 3 months to live. That person should never, ever, ever be in a situation in any kind of a civilized society where a system or a government is keeping them alive against their will. That is beyond belief, because that doesn't benefit the family. The family has to go on with that, that particular person. And if there are resources, you know, people make the calculated decision, well, you know, I'm not going to go through all this treatment that I really can't afford so I could be here another 2 weeks. That is a decision that every person has to make for themselves. Or perhaps they do it. You know, everybody says, well, we don't care. We don't care about the property. We just want another couple of months with Pop-Pop. That's okay. But that's your decision. That is not the decision of a bureaucracy. That is not the decision of the medical system. And it's certainly not the decision of any sort of religious community. Folks, I can't tell you how passionate I am about this. These are situations. There is a place for government. And, you know, I'm not one that believes in anarchy, because if you had anarchy, you know, we wouldn't want to see anarchy. And I think we're just about getting ready to see anarchy in the United States of America. But that all said, government needs to stay out of the way in certain things, separate the good intention from the bureaucracy, and life will be that much better. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. I'll be right back in 60 seconds.
Today's the day that all us cats must surely do our bit. We all must do our share so Uncle Sam can hit. Save up all your pots and pans. Save up every little thing you can. Don't give it away. Get some cash for your trash, yeah. Save up all that old newspaper. Save and pile it like a high skyscraper. Don't give it away. Get some cash for your trash. In between we'll do some loving. White handsome turtle doving. Will you listen to me, honey? Get plenty of the folding money. Save up all your iron and tin. But when you go to...
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. In the interest of time, I'm going to keep this brief. A weasel goes to the soda fountain and sits at the stool, and the man asks the weasel, "What would you like?" "Pop," goes the weasel. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. So grateful for all your support, your encouragement, your comments, and we'll be doing it again next week with more stuff. Bye, Kemosabes. God bless. Thank you.
Think of you when the rain is falling. I hear you calling to me. I think of you. I think of you every minute. I lie awake each lonely night. I think of you, yeah, that day you walked away and out of sight. But now my don't